Saddle up the gray, who'd be the rider? Down to the Stillhouse to get a little cider. Saddle up the gray horse, who'll be the rider? Down to the Stillhouse to get a little cider.
Cider is an alcoholic beverage made from fermenting apple juice. Cider was the most popular alcoholic drink in the U.S. from colonial times through Prohibition. John Adams advocated drinking cider over water every morning due to sanitary concerns with well water. Hard apple cider is weaved into American folklore, such as the legend of Johnny Appleseed. Now, what many do not know about Johnny Appleseed, whose real name was John Chapman, is that Chapman wasn't growing apples for pie, he was growing them for hard cider. Obviously, apples have coexisted with humanity for quite some time. It was the apple, of course, that was eaten in the Garden of Eden. Cider is believed to have been invented by the Celts, and the first documented instance of fermented apple cider occurred in 55 BCE during the Roman expansion into Britannia. But it is thought that the drink had existed centuries before its first documentation. Apple trees were brought to America with early English settlers. By 1607, Jamestown had a functioning cider orchard, and in 1620, the Pilgrims traveled with a cider press on the Mayflower that ended up saving the ship when a large beam cracked and the screw of the press was used to stabilize the ship until it could cross the Atlantic. In 1634, Lord Baltimore, the founder of Maryland, directed settlers to grow both apple and pear trees for, in his words, the making thereafter of cider and perry. Perry is cider made from pears. In a short time, cider was the most popular and widespread alcoholic drink in the English colonies. Water sanitization in the urban colonies was not sufficient enough to prevent the spread of bacteria and microbes from the concentrated urban population of humans and animals. Drinking brackish water, a mixture of salt water and fresh water found in coastal areas, led to dehydration. A cholera outbreak in 1848 spread from New York City to Boston in a matter of months and killed many before an effective sanitation system was developed. Hard apple cider was safer to drink than water in early America. It is estimated that gallons of cider per week were consumed by early Americans, both young and old.
Cider's popularity in America continued into the early 20th century when the temperance movement led to the institution of prohibition. With prohibition and the corresponding Volstead Act, production of sweet, non-alcoholic cider was limited to 200 gallons per year because sweet cider can be easily fermented by the consumer. The majority of cider orchards were burned to the ground, and only non-cider apples were allowed to be replanted. This caused a permanent loss of many varieties of cider apples that had been selectively cultivated in the preceding 300 years. After Prohibition, breweries could return to production almost instantaneously with imported grains and annual crops of barley, wheat, and rice. For orchards, it would take decades for apple trees of cider varietals to bear fruit. This lull in production allowed for a shift in taste and preference of the American consumer. Beer and grain-based alcohol were now their drink of choice. Globalization in the 1980s and 90s allowed for an economical return of cider to the Americas. Strongbow cider, a British cider, was one of the first hard ciders to gain popularity and distribution in America. While initially an import-only beverage, soon cideries began returning to hard cider production. From 2013 to 2014, cider sales grew 75.4%, and overall in the past 3 years, sales have quintupled for the category. The Cider Act of 2016, lobbied for by representatives of cider-producing states, sought parity in taxation with craft beer. Previously, cider was taxed more like wine at $1.22 per gallon. The Cider Act lowered the tax rate to 22 cents per gallon for ciders under 8.5% alcohol by volume. In addition, cider is gluten-free. This and the substantially lower cost to the consumer continues to spur growth in the industry. Some challenges still remain as different states have different laws regulating distribution and manufacture of alcoholic beverages. As the craft cider industry grows, market differentiation is bringing not only new styles such as hot cider to the consumer, but also a return to historical styles as it is becoming economically viable to reproduce cider varietals through breeding programs that haven't existed since colonial times. Another area of differentiation is organic farming. Quite a challenge for an orchard in the hot and humid climate of the mid-Atlantic coast. The cider industry continues to grow in the United States as tastes are once again changing. Of the four cideries we will be speaking with, two are farm-based cideries, one is a large regional operation, and two are located in urban areas of Washington, D.C. and Richmond, Virginia. The variety of styles, approaches, historical knowledge, and business types provide a diverse overview of this revitalizing industry.
Yeah, so I met cider in graduate school, mm-hmm. and French cider, and really loved it, and thought that would be a fun thing to do if I ever ended up with a farm and an orchard somewhere, or just an apple tree in my yard. So we're the oldest, we're the longest established organic farm in Maryland, and the longest established certified organic orchard in the Middle Atlantic states, perhaps in the East. We're not entirely sure about that. We started planting the fruit in 1985, and with the intention of making cider, but it wasn't. With the intention of making cider and then an apple spirit, we hoped. But those things were not allowable within the law in Maryland, and so it did not allow us to do that for a number of years. Part of the business plan was thinking about growing heritage apples with the thought that someday I might be able to make cider, and that we might be able to sell heritage apples at the same time, because they taste great, and they have largely been lost from the shelf of commercial grocery stores because they are odd looking, and some of them are odd tasting, which is to say some of them are spitters, right? Mm-hmm. Which have more acid and tannin, much less sugar. And most of our modern apples in the United States, at least, are more about sugar with some acid and no tannin, and they've been getting rid of the astringency in apples.
Okay. So heritage apples, what's the history behind those?
Well, those are the apples that most of them were probably seedlings here. You know, John Chapman is real. Johnny Appleseed is real. And indeed, he was a nurseryman who planted apple orchards in advance of the settlers moving into the Ohio Valley and along other river valleys. He died a millionaire, which is kind of interesting for that period of time, I think. But he planted the nurseries, then as settlers moved in there, he would have apple trees that were ready to bear that people could buy from him and put in their yard. And then, you know, a number of those seedlings became things that folks worked to improve. Some of them they really liked, some of them they didn't like, and so that's part of it. Part of it is also that we have, you know, the early settlers planted seeds. The oldest American apples are russet, golden russet and Roxbury russet, and each of those was actually planted by a Dutch settler. They're actually genetically related apples, and who knows where they came from, but they probably came across the water in somebody's shoe to keep the rats from eating it, and they got planted, and they make wonderful cider. all by themselves. So we use the heritage apples. We grow about 20 American heritage apples.
Okay.
So, for example, we grow both types of russet. We grow Pippin, which was George Washington's apple, and the apple that he used for his to make his cider and to distill it into the spirits that he sold. We grow Spitzenberg, which was Jefferson's apple that he did the same with. We grow Black Twig, which is Andrew Jackson's apple that he did exactly the same thing with. Interesting that three of our forebears were in the alcohol business, I think, before Prohibition. But anyway, that's another story. So we grow these heritage apples because they have a combination of sugar and tannin and acid, just like wine grapes do. And that's why they ferment into such lovely cider. So initially, you know, we had you had wineries and breweries and distilleries, but what's a cidery? And so it didn't really fit any of those places. And so many state laws had to be adjusted to allow ciders to fit breweries or wineries or wherever they might actually be. We're a winery. We're a winery because as we got our license, the alcohol content of our ciders is high enough because the sugar in an organic fruit is high enough that, you know, we it's above 7%, so it needed to be a wine, not a beer. And so that's but it also is reflective of the way we treat the juice. We treat it more like a wine than a beer. You can make cider either way, and it's good either way. Up until a year or a year and a half ago, it was by far the fastest growing segment of the alcohol industry, of the spirits, the greater spirits industry. It's slowed down in the last year and a half. I'm not quite sure why, but it has. It's still growing, but just not growing at the rate that it was growing. I think it will continue to grow. I think it is a beverage that hasn't quite figured out what its target market might be yet. We see two different ways that it is treated. One is, maybe three. So there is a type of cider that is a sweet product or a sweeter product that's akin to hard lemonades and things like that, and has a pretty good market. There is a type of cider that is more traditional cider, which is to say that traditionally there was no way to stop fermentation. And so it ferments all the way out, and that's treated more like a wine. And that's where we actually go.
So, is there anything, if you were to go back, is there anything you would have done differently?
We probably would have pushed harder earlier to have gotten the laws revised the way they needed to be revised. In order to have been into the industry even earlier than we were. I think that's probably the thing that I might change. What you taste here is stuff that grows here. There are relatively few other options for organic fruit around. We have a really nice relationship with Sunnyside Organics down in Little Washington, Virginia, and we are able to get a few apples and a few pears from them most seasons, which helps supplement what we grow. We have about 12 acres of fruit here. We have 5 acres of apples and 1 acre of pears and 1 acre of grapes and 2 acres of blueberries, and then the rest is assorted fruit from apricots to blackberries to other things.
Okay, in the microbrewing industry, there have been trends towards higher gravity beers, such as IPAs and Imperials, creative sours, and other variations on traditional styles. How is this parallel in the craft cider industry?
That's a good question. We have noticed, we hosted a tour from CiderCon, which is the international convention of cider makers. So we hosted a tour last winter, and we're being encouraged by folks there to enter the international competitions, which I missed by a day because I put it on my calendar wrong. That's a long story, and I'm embarrassed. But in the competition, you see those kinds of things now reflected as categories. So there will be a category for sours, for example. There'll be a category for varietals that, like our black twig or our russet, that's just those apples that are in that, right? Or predominantly those apples, like a wine variety. There'll be sparkling categories. There'll be still categories. There'll be perry categories, which is pear. I hesitate to use the word cider because cider means apple, but perry just means pear. And so that variety of categories in the competitions has emerged, and I think that that is reflecting what we're actually doing in the industry. So we usually mill the fruit for a while, which means that we allow it to sit out and sweat, which is to say it evaporates some of the water out, concentrates some of the sugar in, and then it goes to the press to be pressed. Then we begin fermentation. And eventually, 8 to 10 months later, that fermentation is finished. We ferment low and slow. And so typically we usually start pressing in November. Mm-hmm. And so it'll typically start fermenting sometime in November. It'll finish fermenting about now, actually. And then because we treat our cider like wine, then it ages for a year in oak barrels. And then some of it ages for us another year in oak barrels. Some of it is ready to bottle at the end of that second year. So we buy used oak barrels. We mm-hmm. prefer French oak, and we prefer white wine French oak barrels. So French oak barrels that have been used for white wine. And so we buy those through barrel brokers. And so they come from France or from California. But it is an historic drink of this nation, at least of the colonists of this nation, because you know it wasn't taxed as other alcohol was in the colonies. Certainly it is an historic drink of Europe as well, and of China, I'm sure. Mm. I don't have any doubt that that's how. We have, for example, we grow 8 types of Asian pears, and 10 types of pears, but 8 types of Asian pears, and 3 of those are Chinese pears from the Yellow River Valley of China. They've been grown for 3,000 years, called what they're called now, like Suri, and they make absolutely stunningly good perry. And so I am certain that part of the reason they survived is because they make stunningly good alcohol.
Do you make any perry here then?
Oh, yes.
Mm-hmm. Oh, you do?
Oh, yeah. Okay. We have 3 that we do. We do one that's called, shall I show you? One that's called Apparition, that is just 2 of our pears. And so that one has a pear called Suri and a pear called Chujuro. And the Suri is 3,000 years old, it's Chinese, and the Chujuro is Japanese, and it's about 600 years old. And that's all that's in that. One of them tastes like pineapple, and the other tastes like butterscotch. And when you put them together, they make a really interesting pairing. And then we do a pairing, which is all of our pears with our fresh ginger that we grow in the hoop down there, and some honey from our bees. And so that's a pear wine that is a perry, and then a cherry perry that we're working on now, which is sour cherry and Asian pears.
Oh, wonderful.
So those are our perries.
We saw a really good opportunity to do cider right in a great city. That's a short answer. So, you know, both my partner and I spent time in places where cider was done really well. So I lived in Spain for a while. They have a very good cider culture there. So they do the product very well, and they do the culture around the product really well, kind of like we do breweries here in the United States. So, you know, having that experience when I was living there after college was sort of eye-opening for me as someone who has always enjoyed cider, but always kind of, you know, just thought it was like a very static, you know, dimensional category that was sort of a replacement to a beer every once in a while, you know, just the way it was marketed in the United States for a long time. So that was eye-opening. And, you know, I knew for a long time that if someone could come in and do both the product and the culture really well, you know, and pick a good city with people who are curious and have a strong foodie streak and are adventurous and want to try something new, that it could be pretty compelling, you know. And my partner comes from a similar background. He was a brewer, and he has a sister, he has many, he's one of 9, who has celiac, and so she couldn't drink beer. So he got into cider, and he was living in Colorado at the time, just as that cider scene was sort of coming online. So they were maybe about 5 years ahead of us here on the East Coast in the Mid-Atlantic. And he kind of, you know, I think bells started going off for me as well, like, wow, this is a really compelling category that could have a lot of depth, you know, if it was in the right people's hands. And so we're seeing that now. It's not really us sort of at the vanguard. I mean, there's a lot of really interesting things going on in cider right now. We look up to two categories of people, I think, primarily. We look up to craft beer unabashedly. So we are really trying to do with cider what the craft beer guys did with beer. So they took the pilsners and the lagers that we all knew so well, you know, and then all of a sudden IPA started happening in the early 90s. And it's like, what's an IPA, you know? And now it's like, I mean, there are so many categories. You can't even, there are no categories anymore, right? So people are pushing the bounds in a way that is just sort of like, making people realize, like, this is a really interesting, like, beer is a sort of boundless medium. So we're trying to do that with cider as well, because those possibilities exist for this category as well, you know. So our hallmarks have been sort of innovation and high rise. That's what we wanted. The other category of producers are the guys up in the Pacific Northwest who have basically done what we were trying to do before us. So they basically took that craft beer culture, that craft beer approach, and they've sort of flooded into cider. So if you think about, you know, Portland, Seattle, places where you have deep craft beer culture, everyone's bought in, and you say, hey, you know what, we can do this with cider also. They're doing amazing things, and so we always kind of look to them and say, you know what, that's kind of the future of this beverage, and that's where we want to take it. So that's what we're trying to do here, and DC's a phenomenal city, right? Zero emission stars a couple years ago, 9 now. The Renaissance in DC, I don't have to really sell anyone on that, and so being able to do that here is really just, you know, we're lucky to be able to do it. I mean, the ingredients are pretty simple. It's primarily just apple juice and yeast, right? And so we're getting most of our apples from Virginia right now, and we're starting to get some of them from southern Pennsylvania as well. So everything's within 2 hours now. So local is, there's not a lot of orchards in DC, but we try to be as regional as possible. And then, you know, with the other stuff, I mean, we get creative. So we have a cherry bloom and a cherry bloom double, and you know, the best place in the world to get cherries is Traverse City, Michigan, and so that's where we get them. So we get whole dark sweets and sour cherries from Traverse City, Michigan to make that one. You know, our citrus comes from Florida, you know. Our hops come from kind of all over the place, so, but 99% of what goes into the product is apple juice and yeast from very close by. Because people are used to some of that higher test stuff now, you know, and so people are willing to sit and kind of enjoy the beverage. It's no longer a competition to drink 8 to 10 beers or something like to sit down and do that. That's no longer like a mark of a, you know, an impressive evening. You know, people are like the higher test stuff on the beer side, you know, has sort of like one character. On our side, the reality is if you take all natural ingredients, you know, so the apple juice harvested at the right time of year to get the right balance of sugars and the right acids and the right flavor profiles, it's going to ferment out to about that sort of 6 to 7, you know, percent ABV range, right? And so the only way to make it not that is just cut it back, right? And so we don't do that. So we don't put filtered water in our product. We don't dump sugar in our stuff, you know. And so everything's natural. So, you know, it's a good confluence of factors that, you know, we're dedicated to making all natural stuff the right way, and the market already gets that. And we do have 20 years of craft brewing, sort of paving the way for us, so that people kind of understand that, you know, you can actually sit and enjoy a beer as opposed to just necessarily crushing a bunch of them, you know, that are like 4% ABV. Yeah, so our marketing is primarily ground level, you know, so it's really getting out there in the ground and just, I mean, we do a ton of tastings. It's human capital intensive, so we're out there, you know, we're out there doing tastings at, you know, grocery stores and liquor stores all the time. We try to take part in as many festivals as possible, so we do the beer festivals. There's a ton of different vessels. DC Beer Week is coming up, you know, and so, you know, there's just a lot of opportunities to get out there and fly the flag, and that's really the best thing, you know, way to sort of make a connection between people and us and our story and the product is to be out there right in front of them. So we spend a lot of time doing that. You know, obviously social media has been just sort of like a great equalizer, which is huge for small businesses, right? A little plug for net neutrality there. Yeah, I mean, honestly, you know, the thing that's going to make people remember you most is, you know, meeting you and tasting a product is good, you know, and knowing where to get it.
Yeah,
good. I'm glad.
That's great.
Yeah. Old Rock was founded in 2012 by two gentlemen, John Washburn and Brian Shanks. John was sort of the visionary on the brand, and he owned the land. He says the brand is the land. But he owned the land and owned the farm where we were founded for about 30 years before starting Bold Rock. And he was approached actually 151, where we are in Nelson County. Route 151 is a pretty well-known craft beverage corridor, and there's a number of first wineries and then breweries and now cideries along this corridor. And around 2008, someone approached him wishing to start their own brewery on his land, but he had become so, in love with the land that he couldn't sell it, but he got really intrigued by this idea of craft beverage, and was actually in New Zealand at the time, and was able to reach out to one of the world's foremost cider makers, Brian Shanks, talk to him, and tell about this dream of starting a hard cider brand in the heart of the Blue Ridge in Virginia, and ask where's Virginia. They're in New Zealand at the time, and he was able to talk Brian Shanks onto an airplane, and they flew over here, and they looked at all the different metrics that you might want to investigate if you're going to start a hard cider brand, which of course, where can you get fresh apples? Do we have a great distributor network already in Virginia, and many of the other different business principles, and so they checked off all the boxes and started a hard cider company here in June 2012, and we've come a long way since. We have two production facilities, one in Virginia, where we are right now, this is our flagship production facility, and then the second just south of Asheville, North Carolina. Of course, they also have apples grown in abundance in Henderson County. It's actually the seventh largest apple growing county by volume in the United States. Then we have two smaller tap rooms at local orchards here in Central Virginia, one at Carter Mountain Orchard, which is just outside of Charlottesville, and then another at Child's Peach Orchard, which is in Crozet, Virginia. So the history, it is a historical beverage, first enjoyed by the founding fathers and the folks who came and settled here from Europe. And it was a great way to potentially head off issues with the drinking water, and so they would make hard cider, very low alcohol thresholds, and enjoy that almost on a daily basis because it didn't make them quite as sick as the water might. It was well enjoyed throughout the 1700s, 1800s, and then Prohibition hit, and a lot of people previously had cider apple trees on their properties. Once Prohibition came, they didn't have much use for cider apples because they're typically not the best to eat. Certainly, great to make a hard cider out of, but not so much to cook with or any of the other uses you might have for an apple. And so they pulled up those trees, and then when Prohibition was lifted, the European influences on beer and wine sort of took hold, and hard cider never really regained its original prominence. Right around 2012, when we were founded, June 2012, cider started to experience a resurgence in the United States. And now we account for roughly about, cider as a category, 2% of the overall sort of craft beer market. Beer is selling 100 bottles, and we're two of those bottles.
Wow, yeah. That's pretty big.
Yeah, well, we've come a little bit of a ways because I guess that previously it was about 1% not all that long ago, and so we've come a long way in a short amount of time. Yeah. The core input, as we like to say, is apples, and so we work with local orchardists within about 35 miles of the cidery here, about 8 different large-scale growers, we like to work local as much as possible. People really want to know where the source inputs are coming from for the products that they consume, and so supporting local agriculture and working with local producers is a really important part of what we do. We also, of course, do more with our styles than just exclusively apple or pear-based products, and so we have like a blackberry, for instance, a blood orange, which we're re-releasing in September, and we have a seasonals program that we try to tinker with. And we start local with those styles, and then we fan out based on quantity and volume, and then also quality. It's a three-tier system in the United States where we as a manufacturer have to work with a distributorship, and the distributorship gets the product to the end user, the retailer, the consumers. And so that's the way we're able to get our products out into our 10-state distribution footprint. And so we have to certainly be familiar with those guidelines and make sure that we're doing everything that we should be in terms of that system, taxes, of course, you know, all the fundamental rules of service to patrons here at the tap rooms. And so yeah, it's a little bit complex, it's fluid, so it changes a fair amount. And so we have to, you know, stay abreast of those changes and change with them. Typically we're, you know, 4.7% to 6% alcohol, so people can enjoy more. Other cider brands might be higher ABV levels. And so that was a wise strategic decision as you look at the marketplace. And consumers are typically, or at least a lot of them, are gravitating towards lower alcohol percentage beers. And we compete in the beer sphere. And so that was a good decision to, you know, target 4.7% to allow for them to enjoy more. You know, we've done a lot of good things with our seasonals program. And we initially released the India Pressed Apple IPA at the height of the craft beer IPA boom. And that's actually risen to be our number two seller.
What is that?
IPA, it's a dry hop style. We start with our Granny Smith blend, and then we use about three different hop varietals to achieve a very nice full hoppy aromas on the nose and a more subtle hoppiness on the taste. And beer drinkers, we like to call it a gateway cider for beer drinkers. And so that's expanded the consumer base to some degree. And then more recently, in February of this past year, we released our rosé style. And that is a gateway cider for wine drinkers. And of course, rosé is a super popular variety of wine at the moment. And so we've been able to expand the pie even further by drawing in wine drinkers to our consumers. This is our production floor. And as you can see here, we've got a number of tanks, and we produce throughout the year, 12 months. Of course, apples are only in season one time per year, but we're entering into the season when we'll source fresh grown apples, and then thereafter we'll source from climate controlled storage, and then following that we'll source from uncontrolled atmosphere. And so that involves, of course, taking out all of the oxygen, replacing with nitrogen, chilling the room down, and that's how we'll be able to continuously press apples on site right here 12 months out of the year. And from there, it's about a 18 to 20 day process. We ferment for roughly 10 days, and then we blend for another 8 to 10 days thereafter. And so we like to say bottling the freshness. We can definitely, I think the consumers can taste it, taste the lightness of the product, and that comes from not having it sit too long in vats and really getting it out the door. It also makes us more agile as a company, where we're able to respond to changes in the marketplace a little bit better than perhaps otherwise. Our products are distributed in six packs. We're on the same shelf as craft beer in many retailers. And so we've aligned ourselves strategically with craft beer, even though we are a winery by classification by the Virginia ABC. Beer is an important segment for us, and we occasionally, you know, take tips from that marketplace and try and deploy in a cider form. And so the IPA was part of that, in that we saw how popular IPAs, a segment of the craft beer industry, were doing, and decided to come up with our own style, albeit, of course, still gluten-free and slightly different than maybe an IPA beer style. But nonetheless, it's got some really nice hoppy aromas and more subtle hoppy taste. And so beer drinkers can see that connectivity with maybe their core preference, and that's how we've been able to draw in new consumers to the cider marketplace.
So what's your favorite cider?
It's so tough. I enjoyed citrus for a long time. That was one of our seasonal varieties. That's been retired, sadly. But I sort of jump around to all of them. And the blackberry right now is our current season, which I've really been enjoying. And that's 4.7% alcohol. It's a blend of mostly apples, but then we also have a little blackberry juice that we put in on the back end, and that provides it with a really nice fruitiness, but then you know, tartness on the back end. And so it's, you smell it, and it smells like it's going to be sweet, but then you taste it, and it's pretty dry, and then it actually gets a little bit tart on the back end, and then that keeps you going back for the next sip.
I used to work in economic development in Washington, and I was really enjoying my career there, but at a certain point, I just didn't want to be inside anymore. And once I realized I was trapped indoors for the rest of my life, it was a non-starter. So I started thinking about ways that I could be involved in agriculture as a career and how I could maybe get into farming. So I kind of noodled about that for a while, and then it dawned on me, I have an uncle who is a winemaker in Washington State, and you know that side of the family is so far away that it took me a while to remember. But he is actually a very well-known red winemaker in Washington. So that's okay. Well, if Uncle Miles can figure this out without land or skills inherited, then maybe it's something that I can learn too. And I didn't want to do red wine. He was already doing that very well. And then didn't want to do white wine if I could avoid it, because Virginia wineries make a lot of white wine. And it felt like a crowded market for a beginner. So I kind of thought about that for a while, what kind of a wine I would make. And there's mead, but there's also fruit wines. And you don't really hear that much about fruit wines. So that was a learning curve for me, but the more I researched it, the more I realized that cider really is a wine. It's just made with apples instead of grapes. And the culture of apple growing is, I just love it. I mean, apple growers. So we look a lot to records, old plantation records. Virginia Historical Society has a lot of information. Old letters, the Revolutionary War, they're throwing letters back and forth talking about apples because it's harvest season and they want cider, and darn this war, we're not able to do that this year. So there's actually a lot of information about apple growing in our state. It's just you have to kind of look in unusual places to find it. So most of our apples are grown in Nelson County. I apprenticed at Albemarle Cider Works.
Okay.
And one of the first things that I learned how to do is to graft a tree. So trees are not true to seed. If you want a particular apple, you have to clone it through a grafting process. And I learned how to graft. I made the trees that I wanted and actually planted them in an urban community garden in Richmond. And I knew it would take a year or two before they would even be a tree worth having. So I planted them like immediately at the beginning of my internship, my apprenticeship. And then 2 years later, I had a business, and we moved those trees to Nelson County. So I do lease the land, but I own the trees. I was looking for an agricultural product that was highly value-added in Virginia. And I think the growth of cider in Virginia comes from the fact that we have a good climate for excellent fruit quality. So, you know, wine has kind of been a little bit of a challenge. There's a constant research process going on for like what's the right type of grape for Virginia wine, but we're one of the top apple producing states in the country. There's no question that apples grow well here. It's a matter of like finding the ones that we want for cider, but even so, there are kind of like secret orchards that never got chopped down during Prohibition.
Really?
And finding those and the people who own them. It's still a little bit of fruit exploring and apple hunting, and there are those people out there who that is their full-time hobby, and it's fun meeting those people. Well, the apples that we're growing here in Richmond, our street trees are Hughes crab, hyssop crab, winter white pearmain, and Grimes Golden. So those are the four that I've kind of pared it down to at this orchard. I had another orchard on the other side of the river in Richmond where I had, I think, 16 different varieties. And through learning and trial and error, I figured out that it's more streamlined to have fewer varieties that bloom simultaneously. If they're blooming at different times, it's harder to manage them when I'm also managing all of these other things in the company. So all four of those pretty much bloom and crop at the same time, which is why I picked everything right before you got here. I did save you one apple. So there's one Grimes Golden still on the tree, but everything else is already down and will go into the press tomorrow.
Oh, really?
Yes.
So is that, how many times, that's one time a year?
Yes.
You harvest everything one time a year?
Yes. And yep. Well, I think the biggest learning curve is learning how to run a business if you haven't done it before. So a lot of people who get into craft beverage think, I'm gonna make craft beverage as a business. And it's really, I'm gonna make a business that makes craft beverage. And kind of getting that into your head is the hardest part. Luckily, I had a really great apprenticeship, so that saved me so much money in mistakes. You know, a lot of people, when they're in their dreamer phase, they go out and they buy land because that's their stake in the ground. I'm changing my life. And that's the last thing that you should do. Like, never buy land if you want to go into agriculture, like right out of the gate. Learn your craft and then figure out, if you can, what is the land that's correct for the work that you want to do. So the biggest part is being a business person, really. And behind those glass doors, that's the cellar. So that's where we make the cider. We turn the apples into alcohol. And it's actually follows a streamlined process. So cider's made, packaged, and then distributed all the way down that set of carriage houses. So it comes out the other end in little boxes and little bottles. And we distribute mostly on site, so probably 80% of our business occurs right in this little third of an acre. But then we do sell to some retail and restaurants, bottle shops. We're at the 1789 restaurant right near you guys. So
yep, right in Georgetown.
I know. Right. And if it's not there anymore, ask for it.
Okay, we will, definitely.
We also sell online, and we have a cider club. So that's really the future, I think, for us. Uncle Miles's wines are 100% club. So if you want the wine, you have to be on the list. And we have some of those ciders here that unless you're in the club, you're not going to get to taste or buy them. But, you know, long term, I would love to be 100% on the
list.
So
can you ship those out of state then?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Because we've talked to a couple other cider makers, and the legislation, especially in Maryland, more so than it seems like here, is pretty complicated.
Every state's different, and you know, I think it's your appetite for regulation and paperwork, which, you know, I'm an entrepreneur, I'm a rule breaker. It's not my second nature, but I have a great compliance attorney, and she manages that for me. So, but that comes at a price. So I don't distribute to all 50 states. We luckily, because we have the club and we've been doing that for a long time, we know where our target market moves. So one of the things about Richmond in particular is we're a good place to start a career, but most people then move to New York or Los Angeles or San Francisco or Florida or Texas. So California, Texas, Florida, and New York, and Pennsylvania has turned out to be a tourist market for us. So we didn't necessarily have club members moving to Philadelphia or Pittsburgh, but we have a lot of passing through travel in the summer, and we tracked that last summer. So pretty much every customer who came in the door, where are you from? And we kept track of that, and then we're like, oh my gosh, Pennsylvania is the sleeper market that we never knew about. So we've started to ship to Pennsylvania as well. Yeah, so we're a farm winery. That's our license type. And normally, alcohol is split into three stages. There's production, distribution, and retailing. And you have to pick a lane. You can't do all three. Mm-hmm. That's the rules, unless you're a farm. So we're agricultural, which means we're required to do all three. So we have to cut across all three of those phases. So we produce, we distribute, and we retail all on site.
That's amazing. Yeah. That's wonderful.
Yeah. Retail is the best. All of that culture was lost during Prohibition, and we're having to dig deep to find it. But cider was the beverage of choice in Virginia for generations. Beer was not easy to manufacture here because it was too hot, and whiskey you shouldn't drink before lunchtime. So there had to be something for breakfast, and that was cider. So, you know, everyone was drinking alcohol all the time, but, you know, within that range, cider was actually what was preferred. And so we know that Jefferson had his preferred ciders for the table because he couldn't make wine. And same for George Washington. He had preferred ciders, you know, fine ciders for fancy dinners, and then everyday ciders for breakfast or, you know, everyday meal. And because we know what those are now, we know what to plant because we know it grows here. There's such a rich culture of cider in Virginia, and we're still waking up to it. It still is. Everyone should have cider on the table for Thanksgiving. Get it together, you know. It has been cider on the table for Thanksgiving for generations until Prohibition, and it like wiped everyone's memory. And we're having to start new. So we're trying to get that back. All right, so eat your crab apple.
Okay.
This is a hyssop crab, and you will taste, it's not very delicious compared to most cider or most apples you're used to eating. Mm-hmm. It's gonna like dry your mouth out. The English call it furring, which I think is a weird term, but it does sort of describe how your mouth salivates and gets really dry. And that's the tannin and the astringency of the cider fruit. So in the same way that a wine grape is not edible like a table grape, a cider apple is not edible like a table apple would be. So when I do a tasting with customers, we'll like actually have the spit bowl and we'll leave them there, but over time they turn deep dark brown because the tannin oxidizes. So I want them to see that this is highly tannic fruit, where a Virginia Gold, one of its claims to fame is it never browns. Why is anyone making cider with that apple? That makes no sense.
And that's the Virginia Gold.
Yes.
Now, why does browning have anything to do with why you wouldn't want to make cider out of it?
Because it's tannic. So the browning is the tannin oxidizing, and I want an apple that turns brown, deep and dark and quick, because that tells me it's full of tannin, probably has a lot of acid like many crab apples do, and those are two of the main ingredients for cider apples. So tannin, acid, and then sugar, which will ultimately be fermented into alcohol. So you want a lot of that too.
So the higher the tannin, why does that make it better necessarily?
Well, it's more round. And so let's start with Hughes crab. So this is a crab apple. Okay. It was George Washington's favorite cider. So this is a fine cider. Thomas Jefferson was also a fan. This was his table wine. And originally cultivated just outside of Williamsburg. The apple itself is gonna taste very similar to what we harvested Hughes crab last week. Mm-hmm. We'll press it this week, and then we'll start fermenting it and just allow it to age in the tank for a few months. It takes time. So tannin and astringency, when it's young, just like with a young wine, a young cider is gonna be like, and it needs time to calm down and mature before it's ready to bottle and share with the world. So we usually release this like March, April, sometimes June. It just kind of depends on how it's behaving in the tank.
Okay, so you taste it up along the mm-hmm. way, and then when
when it's ready.
You decide it's ready, and then you'll bottle it. You bottle mm-hmm. it here, right?
Yes, we bottle it here and label it here. This is the old labeling machine, my fingers. But we have a real labeling machine now. So there might be a time when during harvest season, things get crazy, ferment gets a little bit ahead of us, but for the most part, that's not what we're looking for.
Okay.
We wanna stay on top of it and get a cultured yeast in there right away, because many wild yeasts are interesting and fun, but some are not.
Right.
And when your job is on the line, you want predictability. So there are different culture yeasts that we'll work with, but I want to be working with the yeast that I know will do, get the job done. So one of the distinctions around Virginia cider, because we get more sunny days than other apple regions, our sugar content is higher, which means our alcohol content is higher. And I really need to work with a champagne yeast okay. so that I know that the ferment will finish.
Right.
We typically clock between 8% and 9% is very normal for a Virginia cider. Most people are accustomed to cider being like 5% or less, mm-hmm. and that's not what our terroir brings us. So, all right, so charred ordinary. I like to call this more of a tavern style. It's predominantly made with wine sap apples, and wine sap was widely grown throughout Virginia. One of the things that makes it a little different from Hughes crab, even though they were both grown at the same time, is a bigger apple. So, I don't have my apples with me, but you can only ever hold three apples in your hand at a time, whether they're big or small. It's just like a physics thing. So, three big apples fills your bucket up a lot faster than three little apples. So you have to do a lot more of this
right.
to harvest the Hughes crab. And that was one of the economic impediments to it being an everyman cider, where wine sap, anyone could grow it in Virginia, anyone could harvest it, whether or not you had bonded labor. So that's one of the reasons why I think that everyone would be drinking this all of the time. You'll also notice that it's really salty, gamey, you know, earthy, kind of funky. And mm-hmm. what were we eating in taverns? Salty, gamey, smoky flavors.
Right.
Yep. So this is actually a really great pairing with all of those profiles. If you were to taste some ham with this, completely change your experience. It can be a little bit on the sharp side for your everyday Joe, but if they eat it side by side with like a nice cheddar or some prosciutto, then suddenly they're like, oh my God, pairings work. All right, so hop sap shandy. This is a dry hop cider. Wine sap is the dominant apple in this one. There's also a little bit of York, which gives it some bitterness. And then the hops are more of an aromatic layer. Because we don't boil it, so that's how you get the bitterness out of the hop, is through boiling. We're not doing that. We're just dropping it in the final ferment, like a tea. And that pulls out the grassy, floral characteristics, a lot of citrus from the hops. And the more that it rests in the bottle, the more aromatic it becomes. So I like this with fish. It's really because of that citrus note. You do get a little bit of a lemon peel, so there is some bitterness, but it's almost like a citrus peel.
Really grassy. It's good.
Yes,
it's
is great. Grassy. It reminds me of springtime in the orchard. Mostly, so we vary it every year depending on harvest and availability, but Cascade is kind of like the consistent base note.
Okay.
So wine sap and Cascade is sort of year after year, but we'll add some things here and there, depending on what we can get. You know, in the beginning of my apprenticeship, I was like, so where do you buy cinewood? And Charlotte, who hopefully you'll meet, was like, nobody sells cinewood. You have to know somebody. Luckily, you know me. And I was like, okay, yeah. So I'm the provenance of the cinewood is important. So our Hughes crab, I got from them, they got from Tom Burford. Tom Burford got from the person who rediscovered it. So I know the lineage of my signs. I know that I have the real Hughes crab. So that's part of how they control that. Harrison, same deal. I got it from Albemarle Cider Works. They got it from Tom Burford. Tom Burford got it from a family in Vermont who got it from the last tree of the last orchard that ever grew Harrison. So I know that I have the true Harrison. Because there are, you'll find in Appleland people who say they have something. Foxwelp is notorious for being, they call it faux whelp, because everybody thinks they have a foxwelp, and it's like 10 different varieties that are all claiming to be the true foxwelp. Well, that, I don't even bother with foxwelp, because I don't know what I'm getting.
So
yeah, every apple seed is a unique individual. And the only way to be sure that you're getting the apple that you want is through a cloning process called grafting, which is ancient. I think the Romans are the first ones to document it, but I know that it predates the Romans, and the people who could graft were like revered as shaman who could make magical life. But there's some woodcuts from the medieval era of people doing different kinds of grafting, sort of as visual aids when you're teaching someone how. So what you have in your glass now, this is called Aragon 1904, and it's named after our first facility, the Aragon Coffee Building, which was built in 1904. And the main apple for this is the Albemarle Pippin. We have a picture of it in there. It's a green apple. And I gave this to a customer literally yesterday. And I said, well, what's your favorite cider? And he named a grocery store brand. And I said, OK, well, try this one. I think you'll like it. And he tasted it. And he said, I'm looking for something that tastes more like a green apple. And I was like, but this is a green apple. And I mean, the bottom line is the color of the apple doesn't matter. It's what's inside the skin that actually creates the flavor. But I think he was looking for something that tasted like a Jolly Rancher, and I don't do that. We make wine out of apples. So actually, the Pippin is, I like to call it the winemaker's cider apple. Some winemakers will dabble in cider from time to time, and because the Pippin has, the juice has some real grape-like characteristics in terms of flavor and acidity, winemakers have a lot of success with that, like right out of the gate. Cider and wine are a little bit different, so it's not always, you know, a straightforward, I would never go and try and make a Gewürztraminer tomorrow, because I know how to do a completely different type of fruit, different pH, different nutritional needs, and that kind of thing. And I would think that a winemaker would have the same kind of, not struggle, but, you know, thinking moment when they're swapping from a grape wine to a fruit wine. So this is actually a good place to start if you're a winemaker, is with the Pippin apple. Yeah. Very fruit forward, almost like a Prosecco or a sparkling Riesling. So this is wild honey, and it is classified as a sizer instead of a cider. So sizer is the old Anglo-Saxon term for apple juice and honey co-fermented. So we started with wild honey and clover with Arkansas black apples, apple juice, fermented that to dry, and then topped it with a little bit of orange blossom honey. So you'll get some floral orange peel notes from that, but you can just smell the honey on this one. And wildflower honey in Virginia has a tendency, I don't know where the bees are finding all this wild mint, but there is like a minty note to wildflower honey, and some people pick that up in the glass on this one. So if you do taste mint, it's the honey. Yeah, so Hughes crab is one of those.
Okay.
So that one went away and was rediscovered in a commercial orchard near the Williamsburg area. So it was actually very close to home where that one was found. Harrison is another heirloom variety that disappeared during Prohibition. And again, the last apple tree was found very close to home. It's a New Jersey apple, and it was found in New Jersey right before it was bulldozed. So whoever had it said, you know, I've heard that people are interested in this apple. We're going to cut it down. And this is the family in Vermont. If you would like to preserve it for posterity, come and collect the sticks, come and collect the science, and we're taking it down next week. So they collected the science and kind of took care of it until Tom Burford then found it and did the final step of testing it against the historic record for, I mean, people wrote down all kinds of weird things about apples, but I mean, that was how you survived. So you wanted to know what it looked like, what were its growth habits, what it tasted like fresh, what it tasted like baked, what it tasted like as applesauce, how it kept in the cellar, and you know what it tasted like fermented. And with all these little data points, you can kind of put together a picture, and that's what Tom has been doing with a number of different apples. So he's kind of a national treasure based in Lynchburg, Virginia.
Wow.
And he writes quite a bit about apple lore, apple history, and historic varieties of apples.